Hello and welcome back to Offspring Magazine, the podcast, and welcome to the last episode of Offspring Magazine, the podcast for this year. That's been a joyous ride for us, hasn't it, Nico? What do you think?
Yes, it's been nice. Let's see how this last episode goes.
Well, you sound a bit depressed. What's happening?
Yeah, I mean, it was nice, the whole thing. Now the first season is over. And yeah, we'll see how we'll continue this, right?
Yeah, definitely. And I'm already sure that we have a few episodes planned for the second season already, right? So, spoiler alert, we have a few episodes coming up sometime next year. So, until then, catch up on all the episodes of this season so that you don't miss the continuity, if there is one. Or is there? I don't know. You'll see. Anyway, so moving into the final episode of this season, it's again an interview with the vice president of the human sciences section of the Max Planck Society and the new vice president of the human sciences section. So what do you have to tell about that, Nico? You have any?
Yeah, so Professor Ullmann Lindenberger is our guest this episode. And yeah, it's going to be interesting. We have like a couple topics prepared that are more specific to the human sciences. So although we are from a different section, we hope this answers some questions for the people in that section. And yeah, we hope we can also ask some more critical questions and see how he responds.
Yeah, definitely, because critical questions are all that is needed in order to get real answers from people. And I hope we get real answers from Professor Lindenberger. Anyway, so the thing to keep in mind is that we have tailored our questions specifically to each vice president. So if you had listened to the previous two episodes, you would have noticed that we hadn't asked the same kind of question to both of them, especially the specific section, specific questions. We have tailored them to each vice president. I hope we did a good job with that in this episode as well.
And if not, you can always send us some questions or topics you're interested in, right? So we're definitely looking forward to any kind of feedback we are getting from you guys.
You folks, let's be more gender neutral. You folks. Anyway,
I'm sorry, yes.
I've been scrutinized over this in the past. Anyway, so I think without any further ado, let's get on with the discussion with Professor Ullmann Lindenberger, the new vice president of the human sciences section. Dr. Lindenberger, thanks a lot for joining us today. We're very happy to have you with us on our podcast.
Yeah, it's really great to have you here. So maybe as a first question, could you give us a short introduction to who you are and what exactly you are doing?
Yeah. First of all, thanks for having me with you. My name is Ullmann Lindenberger, and I'm currently a director at the Max Planck Institute for Human Development in Berlin. And if you ask me what I'm doing in terms of research, I'm a developmental psychologist. Mm-hmm. So I'm interested in how people change with age and why they differ in the way they change with age. And I'm of a specific type of developmental psychologist. I'm what is called a lifespan psychologist. So I'm not specializing on a particular age period, but rather I'm really interested in looking at the entire lifespan from early childhood to old age. Of course, nevertheless, I have a certain focus area, and you can say that I'm probably best known for my work in the domain of cognitive aging, so in what you may call normal human cognitive aging, mm-hmm. how things change in later adulthood. But if you look at my broader upbringing and at my more general outlook on development, it encompasses the entire lifespan.
Okay. And one thing, I mean, the main reason why we are also interviewing you today is because you recently became one of the new vice presidents of the Max Planck Society. And so we wanted to also ask, how did you arrive at your current position? So on the one hand side as a director scientifically, but also as the vice president? And how was your career in general? So if there were any like major milestones that you reached and then that made you think, okay, I want to become a scientist.
Yes. I mean, of course, there's always a lot of reconstruction of post hoc rationalizing in answering these questions. But there are some documents, such as little essays I wrote that as a child, that suggest that I actually always wanted to become a scientist. And more precisely, I always was interested in behavior. So like as a 9-year-old, I really wanted to become an ethologist. I wanted to observe animals. I think this was largely due to my grandmother giving me books by Konrad Lorenz at the time. And so this interest in behavior has been with me, I think, for most parts of my life. And my other big passion is music. So I would have loved to become a composer or a conductor. But I realized that I was not good enough on my instruments. And I also think that the passion for music in the end was not as strong as the passion for science. I was very fortunate that when I ended high school, my father, who is a nuclear physicist, went on a sabbatical at UC Berkeley, and I had the privilege of just coming with him. And I didn't know at the time whether I would study psychology or biology, because I really was interested in the interface and in understanding basically the mapping between what's happening at the brain level and how this changes over time, and what's happening at the behavioral level and how this changes over time, with a focus on behavior, basically. How does the brain, in interaction with the environment, produce behavior? And I wasn't quite able to find that field. And so eventually I decided to study psychology when I came back to Berlin. And then only later I realized that there is a field in the making, namely the cognitive neuroscience field, that actually really tries to merge the two. So I feel very, very fortunate that I was born at a time where this field has been emerging, because the emergence of this field has been very much my own scientific upbringing. My wife sometimes makes fun out of me because I was born in West Berlin in a city district called Nikolassee, which is part of Zehlendorf. And now the institute that I'm directing is in Dahlem, which continues to be a part of Zehlendorf. So when my wife, who is Italian, wants to make fun out of me, she says that I managed to move from one part of a city district to another part of a city district. I have been at some other places in the meantime, but to make things even more extreme, my first job as a student research assistant was at the MPI for Human Development. So I have been with this institute with some these were friendly transitions, from 1984 onwards. And so basically this place is very much part of my biography. Now, if you ask me, I after doing my habilitation in 1999, I got an offer as professor at the University of the Saarland in Saarbrücken. And then, I was very lucky to have extremely friendly and collaborative colleagues there. So we managed to get a DFG Forschergruppe together, and we managed to be part of an SFB, Sonderforschungsbereich, cooperative research program, so that then I had basically the credentials to be considered for director at my own former institute in 2003. So then in 2003, I became a director at the institute. And now, how did I become vice president? I think the proximal answer is because I got a call from the president and he asked me whether I would do that. Perhaps in terms of track record, I have been the chair of the human sciences section before. So perhaps one thing that was in my favor was the fact that I know at least the section pretty well. And I also have had contacts across sections because due to what I just told you, it comes as a natural that I'm also very much interested in some of the things that are going on in the biomedical section. So I already felt pretty much at home when I was asked by the president to do this. And then I also got to know the other two vice presidents who had been asked. And then rather quickly, I had the impression that the four of us just would be a great team and that it would be really fun to work with them. And I just generally like to face new challenges and said, okay, let's do it.
That's a very nice answer that you gave. So going along the same direction, so we're a bit curious. So how was your first few weeks as the vice president? And how much of your weekly time do you spend for your work as a vice president?
That's a tough question because you have to be honest to yourself. So I knew that you would be asking me this question. I would say 70%. And you have to actively make sure that it's not 100%, because if it's 100%, then this means that you really lose contact to your research. And I really would like to remain active enough as a researcher in order at least not to lose contact to the field in those areas that matter most to me. So I think you have to maintain a certain level. And 70-30 is probably a relatively honest answer. There are some weeks where it's more like 80-20, and then there are some weekends or vacations where it comes close to 50-50. And I think a more accurate answer I will be able to give in a year from now. So my first weeks, I would kind of slowly get into this, and I was really overwhelmed by how many different aspects this task comprises, and duties and responsibilities that I wasn't fully aware of before. And so I would say the first few weeks were a bit rough in terms of trying to sort out things. And now, I mean, I've started this in July, and now I would say I have somewhat of an overview of what my tasks are and what the different timelines are, and I now feel that there's also some time to reflect. And I'm very much looking forward to a meeting that the president and the vice presidents will have later this month, where finally we will sit down without a strict agenda and just kind of engage in some strategizing and in kind of reflecting on what our goals are. And I'm very much looking forward to this.
So basically, you're there discussing then a bit the future of the Max Planck Society and in which direction you might want to take it.
Yes, if you exactly. So I think there are so many things that require immediate action and where you just have to function and make sure that the shop is running. I mean, foremost the president, but also the vice presidents, that you tend to get into a reactive mode. And I think it's important to also be in a proactive mode. And for that, you need these spaces to just sit down and think. Yes.
Okay, maybe then, I mean, one thing, I guess this is always important for research institutions that are on the like higher end is good personnel, right? So one thing that is written like quite large, I think, in the Max Planck Society is excellence. And so one thing we've been wanting to ask you is what your opinion is on or how to rather define excellence. So what is an excellent PhD student or a postdoc or a PI? So what does it require to be or have that excellence?
Okay, so let's start with a PhD student. Of course, I think you need to be genuinely curious. You need to have a genuine interest in finding out how things work. And of course, also the intellectual potential to then look at these things in greater detail. I think you need to connect themes or theories with methods. That is, you need to be able to jump between like the general question you are interested in and all the nitty-gritty details that are involved in giving an answer to that question that is valid within the standards of the fields you are working in. So you need to have respect for methods. I think that's highly important. Then I think you need to have a good feeling for realizing that you haven't understood something. So I think this is what you may call a metacognitive skill, to realize that what you thought was an answer was not really an answer. Now, of course, that can only go up to a certain point, because at some point you need to operate on the basis of assumptions, and some of the questions are also beyond your field. So you have to somehow be able to know how deep you want to dig and how deep you need to dig in order to get something that is okay or that is solid within your field. Then it's good not to be afraid of people who know more than you, but rather to look at them as a resource. So I think it's good whenever there is somebody around and he knows how to do something that matters to you better than you do, not to kind of gravitate away from that person, but rather try to get in touch with him or her and learn about the things. So yes, so that's perhaps, and what I just said about a PhD student, I think also holds for all the other two levels that I'm now moving to. So now as a postdoc, you have to kind of shift your horizon a bit. So you just have become one, if all went well, you just have become one of the world experts, let's say, on a specific topic and a specific method, and you have really done a great job in answering some specific questions, like a funnel, so to say, and now you have to open up again. So then it's good to try to look for other labs or other people at the same place, related research questions, other methods, and you then realize that you were as a super privileged position as a PhD student, even though you didn't realize while you were one, because you had this enormous privilege of basically working on one research question full time for 3 or 4, sometimes 5 years. And you will never, ever have this luxury again. From now on, you will have to learn to work on several topics at the same time. So all the issue about prioritization and choosing the people you want to work with, diversifying without getting lost, remaining the master of your time, and orchestrating your life along several themes. And I'm just talking about science here. There's, of course, also the orchestration with the other part of life. That becomes more important. So you have a bigger choice set, and you need to learn how to make good use of it. And then as a PI, you are basically, you need to provide a framework for others. You need to provide some project identity. What is the project about? You need to make sure that people feel at home in the project you are leading. You need to recognize the skills and the talents of the people that work with you. You need to put trust and confidence in the junior people, and need to guide them in ways that match their skills. And I think the best thing that you can achieve as a supervisor is to, and it's very much a pedagogical task, it's very much what you also would find with children and parents, is to give them more credit initially than they actually have, basically pretend as if they were already at a point where they not yet are, so that then at the end they really own the product and really feel, yes, this is what I have accomplished. And you as a supervisor know that perhaps initially you have had some big part in this, but this big part has become completely unimportant. The student has to feel that it's really his or her achievement, and then it really has become his or her achievement. But it's so I think that each supervision period goes through a sequence of empowering the student, giving him some credit, helping him or her, and then if all goes well, at some point the student just takes it and runs with it. And when that works, then it's always a very satisfying, very gratifying outcome.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's a very comprehensive list of qualities you described. And I'm fairly confident that many people in the Max Planck pretty much adhere to these qualities that you mentioned, or at least try to, or aspire to be like this. Yeah. So as the PhD students, we have a collective known as the Max Planck PhD Net, right? And we conduct a survey every year. And recent surveys with the doctoral researchers sort of discovered that the humanities section, or at least the students in the humanities section, on average receive less income than the other two sections. So do you know why this is the reason, or why such a scenario exists, why humanities section seems to be favored or less favored in terms of salary concerns?
Yeah, I think to some extent I do, because the disciplines represented in the human sciences section almost never ever qualify for the kind of bonus that you might get if you are in one of the other disciplines. And I can give you an example. In my own research unit, we have people from many different backgrounds, and we also have computer scientists. In fact, there are some computer scientists who have done their PhDs at our institute, and they typically get TVÖD 50 plus 50%, I mean 50%, TVÖD 50%, plus a 50% bonus, which is called Mangelfachzulage, which reflects the fact that as computer scientists, they could easily get a better paid job somewhere else. So in the end, they get close to 100% TVÖD 13. It doesn't match exactly, because actually the Christmas bonus is only paid when you have a true 100% and not a 50 plus 50, but it's basically it's a full TVÖD E13 salary. Whereas many of our normal students, that means those who come from, let's say, psychology, only earn TVÖD E13 50%. And then now you have those that have a stipend, that have a work contract from a grant from the German Research Foundation, and they get actually 65% E13. And then you have those who come from with a stipend from the Deutsche Studienstiftung, and they may still get something else. So you have a big inequality of payment, not only between sections, but even within sections. And even, as I just told you, within this one and the same research unit at the same institute. And of course, this is not that has nothing to do with justice. It has only to do with basically what the market or the different funding agencies offer at the time. So we have now started to pay TVÖD E13 65 as a minimum to all students at our institute as of this year, because we just don't think that it makes any sense that Max Planck pays below the level of the DFG. I know that the Max Planck leadership agrees with this. I also know that there are some difficulties in making this a general rule for Max Planck that have nothing to do with us, but have to do with negotiations outside. So Yes, I think for all of these reasons, the general level of pay in the human sciences section is lower than that in the other sections. At the same time, the relative proportion of women in PhD positions is also higher in the human sciences section. So as a combination of these two, this also contributes to gender differences in pay as a function of the fact that there are more women in the human sciences section than in the other sections working on their towards their PhD.
I mean, generally, I think if you get like a fellowship that does pay less, this is more on yourself because, I mean, it is prestigious to get fellowships, right? So this definitely is a good part for your CV. But I mean, paying like the Max Planck Society, paying their regular students only a 50% contract, which I know is based on the Fördervertrag, which is then connected to government. So it's really hard to change these things. But apparently it is possible to pay up to 60 or at least 65%, which I think if you consider the money, so if you have 50%, it's like, let's say, 1,200 euros roughly. Oftentimes you have to pay like up to half for the rent. So you don't have a lot of money actually just left for living. And I think it's just a bit of a shame that in the Max Planck Society, which is one of the most prestigious research institutions in the world, you have to worry about, okay, can I actually afford going out or can I not? So this is, I feel like, a bit of a shame.
Yes. So in this case, my answer can be short, full agreement.
So yeah, I mean, I hope this will it's possible to change this in the future. I mean, I think it's nice that your institute is taking a first step there because, yeah, as we discussed, the humanities shouldn't be neglected there.
Yes, I agree.
Mm-hmm. All right, then maybe to change topics a bit. So one thing that, I mean, I have to admit, I like the Max Planck Society quite a bit. And so one thing that we've been also discussing in the PhDNet a bit is basically this brand of the Max Planck Society. And as far as I remember, you also discussed it and had it in your interview when you started becoming, being a vice president. So I wanted to ask, like, how do you think this brand of the Max Planck Society should be broadcast along in the international research community?
Yes. So first of all, I don't want to take anything away from how proud and happy people are as members of a given institute. I know that the institute identity is important, and that's the institute or the department of your institute is your social reference group, and certainly that's the local connectedness to the Max Planck Society, and that matters a lot. I would say we don't lose anything if we strengthen Max Planck as a brand. And my experience from talking to colleagues is that they often know about a specific institute, or perhaps also two specific institutes, because they are part somehow close to their own field, or because they have been visitors there or whatsoever. But they don't even know that Max Planck is an organization with well over 80 institutes. So Max Planck as an organization is much less well known, I would argue, among our colleagues from abroad and from other institutions than the individual institute. And I think the advantage of strengthening Max Planck as a brand and also as an identity for all of us is that then we really are perceived as a global player, not only within a given specialty area, but in general when it comes to basic research. So then people are aware that this is like Harvard or Oxford or Stanford or UCL, an institution that covers a vast range of different disciplines and that really is a leader in science and scholarship in general. And that creates momentum that can be used in many ways that ultimately also reflect on the strengths of each individual institute. And it reflects also on our ability to recruit directors in areas where we are not yet so well known. So how of it is relatively easy to select very good people in areas where you are already known. But if you want to reach out into new fields, then doing this with a strong brand is more likely to be successful than when you when the name recognition is primarily based on specific institutes. Now, you really asked me how to do that. And that's, of course, I only answered why it's good, and I didn't say much about how it's done. I think it starts with trivial things, such that the Minerva has to be on the websites of all institutes. I think it may start with the fact that we as directors should perhaps spend like 1 or 2 minutes of some of our lectures in explaining to people what the Max Planck Society is. So I think there are many little things in the way we are we present ourselves in the web, but also personally to our colleagues, that can strengthen that brand.
Mm-hmm. So also, for example, at the end of talks that you thank the Max Planck Society for funding and these
kinds. For instance, yeah.
Okay. Actually, I have a follow-up question to what you were saying before. So these new fields, I think it's really hard to start new fields. And if you're then the first person, like the first director joining the Max Planck Society, even though the funding might be good, you don't have any infrastructure for the field. So would you say that it's like taking a lot of time out of your schedule just to set this all up? And doesn't this make it really hard to establish new fields in the Max Planck Society?
Yes. First of all, I do think that probably my colleagues from the other two sections, where large and expensive equipment is more of an issue than it is in the human sciences section, probably have thought more about this problem than I have. So I will be very curious to listen to the podcast of my two colleagues, how they have answered that question. I do think that in some cases this can only be done by starting an entire institute with a new field. So I think we should distinguish between reorienting a department within a given institute or reorienting an entire institute, which may happen, for instance, quite naturally if you have a situation where most directors retire within a relatively limited period of time, then in principle the Max Planck Society can raise the question whether this is a good opportunity to reorient the entire institute toward a different field. And then I think this needs to be very carefully planned. Probably in many cases, it will be good to have something like a founding director and to have a concerted effort that then also comes with the equipment. And I do think that this needs a very careful planning in order to set such a place up. We have had precedents for that, of course. The precedents that we do have, and some of in many cases they are highly successful, are the new institutes that we founded after unification, where all of a sudden we had a massive expansion and had the opportunity to really found several institutes from scratch. So It has been done, it can be done, but it requires a special effort. Now, sometimes you can also take the risk and just put a new field into an old context, if you wish. So you have an institute and it has, let's say, 4 departments, 3 are currently ongoing, and then you take the 4th department and you go into a entirely new direction. And I say this is a risk because you do not know whether that colleague will feel at home at this institute, but it's also a big opportunity because this person then may also change the way people in the other departments think, and it may create some unexpected dialogue that may not only profit the new colleague, but also the colleagues that are already there. So sometimes there also is a case to be made for adding a new research team and a new field to an already existing mix.
Okay, so a lot of these decisions about starting a new institute and stuff like that are actually done on the society level, right? They're done at the Max Planck Society, and it involves a lot of these large organizational bodies like the Senate, the Executive Committee, etc. So how do these bodies perceive the PhDNet, which is a completely student-run group, like a student-run initiative? So is there any sort of recognition of the PhDNet among these large administrative bodies of the Max Planck Society?
My personal experience for answering this question are limited, but they do exist because I've been a section chair before I was appointed vice president. And in that function, I also was part of the Senate for a number of years, which was about the time where the PhDNet came into existence, I think. And my general impression is that the PhDNet is definitely heard. The question how satisfied the PhD students are with their experience as pre-doctoral students and what they think could be improved is very much at the attention of these decision-making bodies. So I do think that is that the creation of the PhDNet is something that has contributed to giving the interests of doctoral students a stronger voice within the society, definitely.
So, I'm sorry, I'm kind of stuck. Yes, I mean, one thing that I think is very important for, at least that's what I've heard, was the survey that is being conducted, right? Mm-hmm. And it shows generally what PhD students think. And it also, like, for considering the Max Planck brand, isn't it that the PhD students who then become professors and mm-hmm. or postdocs and then hopefully also PIs at some point, or also if they just don't go into academia and go outside, they kind of also have this Max Planck brand, right? Or they mm-hmm. kind of give this or portray it to other people. So if they have a good experience, doesn't that also help the whole Max Planck Society in this end?
Yes. First, let me say a few words about the survey. As far as I can see, the PhD survey was the first kind of empirical tool to find out about PhD student satisfaction and interests within the Max Planck Society. And as you certainly know, in the meantime, Max Planck as an organization is also working or has begun to work on its own survey. And I actually have been very actively involved last year taking the existing survey, I'm not talking about the Max Planck survey, and using my psychometric upbringing to shorten and improve the survey. So we now have a Max Planck survey, and I, together with a postdoc, have looked just as the psychometric properties, item total correlations, Kronbach's alpha and what have you. And so that we now hope that we will have a more compact and more valid and reliable survey that the various institutes can use to find out about working conditions at the institute. And it might well be that this development towards Max Planck leadership wanting to have a survey about institutes was in part fueled by the impression, let's put it this way, that perhaps the PhDs know more about the various institutes than we do. And of course, that's great if the PhD students know a lot, but we also would like to know a lot. So we had the impression, hey, somehow we have to do something. So that just as an aside, so I think it's a good example how an initiative that was how an initiative of the PhD students has helped the Max Planck Society as a whole to move towards a more empirical stance in trying to understand what's going on at the various institutes. Second part of your question, of course, yes. I mean, this is not just about successful scientific careers, but it's also about those who might leave academia after a successful PhD and want to and then go in other parts of the job market and are in a way contributing to the image of Max Planck at large. So the goal has to be to be a good employer and to be to provide for a good PhD experience for everyone within the Max Planck Society. Of course, I should also say that we, that as a research organization, our primary aim is on recruiting PhD students in the first place who have this basic curiosity that I talked about in the beginning. But that's the selection part, that's the recruitment part. Once you have been selected, then we should do all we can as supervisors and as an institution to provide for a successful PhD experience. Having said this, I think that the sense of agency is also important. What do I mean by that? I mean that it's good that we have good programs, that we provide soft skill training, that we provide networking and so on. And so there's a lot that we as supervisors should provide, but that should not kind of lead to a mindset, and I know that this might be somewhat provocative, where basically the students think everything has to be given to me. That would be the wrong mindset. You need the sense of agency, the sense of ownership that I talked about at the beginning of the interview is terribly important. And so I think that all these helpful measures should be provided in a way that makes the students stronger, so to say.
Mm-hmm. And I completely agree with your point. I mean, it's not that you should, okay, I get into Max Planck Society and then I'm done with my PhD. I don't know to do anything anymore.
Exactly. Yeah,
this impression is really not good, because I mean, the work only starts then, I would say. Yeah, and maybe so concerning the work of the PhD students in generally, I feel like a lot of times it's more specific to the institute. So also, as you mentioned, that basically you have to focus on a certain thing. But I mean, especially, I guess, coming from your research where it's so interdisciplinary, don't you think it's maybe possible or necessary even to increase the collaborations within the Max Planck Society?
Yes. I think that such a network of collaborations would need to exist as a context for a dissertation. So I think it is kind of tough, not impossible, but kind of tough to in quote, use the student for exploring whether a collaboration with Institute X might actually work. Because then if you think of 3 or 4 years, then the student probably will spend a year trying to understand how this may work before he or she can actually start with the work. So I think it starts even before that. The question is, how big is the potential, the not yet exploited potential, that scientific potential that could accrue from institutes collaborating more closely than they currently do? And if this potential is not exploited, then the question is why. There, of course, a first thing that comes into mind is the fact that in contrast to a normal university, we are geographically distributed all over Germany. Now one has to say, perhaps Corona also makes people realize when it's all over that that remote communication through video means can be pretty effective, at least if a first step has been taken already. So I don't think that you will start a collaboration in this manner, but you may start it by some initial meetings and then you can keep it running. So perhaps Corona will change that part to the better in the sense that that we will see more of these collaborations. I can give you one specific example. We are collaborating with Tobias Bonhoeffer in Martinsried, trying to bridge the gap between animal models of skill acquisition and human skill acquisition. And that requires animal models with two-photon imaging, then animal models with magnetic resonance imaging, and then human studies with magnetic resonance imaging, basically trying to get a more fine-grained understanding of what the changes that we see at the human level may mean, because we can retrace it back through the rodent model to the more molecular changes such as dendritic sprouting and so on. And now Tobias and I are talking about this project for 2 years, and now we are in a position where we can actually start a PhD project. But the groundwork needs to be done beforehand. Otherwise, you basically use the PhD student as a guinea pig, and that's too risky. Yeah.
So do you also think that because the Max Planck Society follows the Harnack principle and each director is very individualistic in their research approach, does this also add a bit of difficulties with, you know, producing collaborations between different labs?
That very much depends on the personalities. So there is no general answer to this question. I do think that collaboration is important at all levels of the hierarchy. And I do think that being challenged and criticized and questioned is as useful for a Max Planck director than it is for a PhD or a postdoc. And there is, of course, the danger that when you are at the top of the hierarchy for a long time, that you somehow are no longer used to being criticized or challenged. But I don't think that this is good for your science. It's, of course, good for your science when you keep being challenged. And so I do think that the principle of having peers around you that challenge your assumptions is enormously helpful for science. And I remember that a few years ago, I got an offer from Stanford. And one of the things that I really liked is that there was a faculty of 20 or 30 people, all in the same building, who provided such a critical collegial context to one another. And I think it's a worthy goal for Max Planck to try to find ways of having a similar spirit also among Max Planck directors.
Okay. I mean, generally concerning collaborations, the Max Planck Society is doing more than just having like the institutes, but rather also collaborating with different universities outside. For example, I mean, you're part of the Wellcome Trust Center, as far as I know it's called. And yep. Also recently, I think you took up the Minerva, I'm not sure, or institution or whatever that is, where it's a collaboration with Israel.
Yes.
So how are these, how easy is it to coordinate those? And also, I mean, I guess, especially during these times, to have like meetings and exchange.
Yes. So as I said before, I think it's much easier to maintain a level of communication through Corona for networks that already have been formed before Corona, than to establish new networks. So when it comes to the Max Planck UCL Center for Computational Psychiatry and Aging Research, this is a center that already is in existence for a few years, I think since 2014. And it's directed by Ray Dolan on the London side and by me on the Berlin side. And we have been collaborating for a while, and therefore we were able to maintain a certain level of collaboration despite Corona. Though I must say that there is simply no substitute for instance, we had what's called a symposium in advance course where we met for one entire week at Castle Ringberg, and most of the time was informal time, and there is simply no substitute for that. I mean, that's impossible in my view. I mean, these going for a walk with someone, having a beer, talking about stuff you didn't have in mind before, coming up with a new experiment. These are things that you cannot schedule in a two-hour video meeting. When it comes to the Minerva Foundation, that's a foundation that has been established before Germany had diplomatic relations with Israel. So it's an old foundation, and it fosters research collaboration between Israel and Germany in various ways. There's a strong collaboration with the Weizmann Institute. There are so-called centers that are founded, not only in relation to the Weizmann, but in relation to universities in Israel, and there are stipends. So there are basically three pillars to that foundation. And I didn't know much about the foundation. I had been in Israel a few times and have some personal ties to Israel. And I was really deeply impressed by the work of this foundation, and also by the collaborative spirit of all parties involved. As an aside, Alon Chen, who is the head of the Weizmann now, has been a director at the MPI for psychiatry before, and we actually have some common interests. So it was relatively easy for me to connect directly also on a scientific level to some of the projects there. But again, I mean, it is a pity that I'm not able to visit Israel currently, and I hope that next year the situation will have improved.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the Max Planck in general is completely funded by the public money, like by taxpayers' money, right? So do you think that the public wants to be more engaged in science, and public outreach from the Max Planck is something that has to be done with more gusto? And what's your opinion on citizen science? I think I've asked a lot of questions here, so perhaps you can take it one by one.
So I completely agree with you that Max Planck is publicly funded and is accountable to what it is doing and should explain what it is doing to the general public. And there are various ways of doing this, press releases of great findings, podium discussions, and many, many other formats. I also think that what Max Planck is funded for is basic research. And so I don't think that we should create a mindset among the public that the value of our work is directly measurable in applied utility. It may be measurable in that sense in the long run, but as we all know, the primary goal of basic research is to find out about the world, and the applied implications of finding out about the world are sometimes indirect and sometimes take a long time to materialize. So I think in communication with the public, it's important to do both, to make sure people understand the ways in which we are useful also from an applied sense, but at the same time to also create excitement and enthusiasm about the very fact of finding out about things. Because if we don't continue to do that, we may end up in a situation where accountability means that every single researcher has to give dozens of interviews and has to write kind of fabricated first paragraphs to grant applications, trying to make a case for the immediate applied utility of his or her own work, when in fact that immediate applied utility does not exist and is not the reason for carrying out the research. So we must do both, I would say. Defend the intrinsic value of basic research and making sure that there are, of course, useful and applied implications of our work. When it comes to citizen science, it's again, it's a very big topic. It has been around for quite a while. For instance, when you think of people observing birds and sharing their observations with others in order to know about which birds go extinct. In my field, I think we need citizen science because we are interested in individual differences in change. And so it's in a way a pity that there are all these people who share details of their lives with Google and whatever organizations are behind the tools they are using and don't share them with science. So there is an entire field of what's called experience sampling that would profit from the close observation of human behavior, for instance, in order to predict when a person with a diagnosis of depression is likely to become depressed again based on that person's variation in mood across time. And this is, of course, only possible with trust. It's only possible if these data are highly protected and if people know that they are not going to be exploited for purposes that they didn't agree to. So in my field, in the behavioral sciences, citizen science should mean data ownership and then sharing that, I mean, data ownership, people sharing their, owning their, the data they produce, informationales Selbstbestimmungsrecht. And if they want to, sharing these data with scientists for some purposes they have agreed to. And I think that would be a wonderful development. And several people in the world are working on it, and it's perhaps slowly getting some traction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, generally, I think it's a bit of a sad, really, that a lot of the public is not as motivated, I guess, as us to do science, of course, on the one hand, but also doesn't show as much of an interest in science. Mm-hmm. And I think, like, for example, citizen science can get people kind of or give them this motivation. Now, I think you have probably interacted more with people in general. And what is your impression? Are people interested in science that come to your experiments?
Yes. I have ample experience with older adults because I have been involved in the Berlin Aging Study, in the Berlin Aging Study 2. And we have conducted probably the largest cognitive intervention study ever conducted with humans, 100 young adults, 100 older adults, 100 days of training. And we actually have made a little documentary about that. It would be great if you could somehow link it to the podcast. And when you watch this little documentary, you realize that these people actually like the idea of contributing to science. They think that it's intrinsically rewarding to do that. Of course, they also do it because they want to help the career, for instance, of the doctoral student who is part of this. So they form a bond to the doctoral student and want, in this case, her to be successful. And I have seen this motive of being part of something meaningful ever and ever again, especially in the older adults in our work. Of course, that also means that we invite them to debriefing sessions, that we write a newsletter and so on. Of course, always trying not to disclose our hypotheses, that's clear. But what I'm saying is there are many ways of, there are many motives that are, that make it easy for us to recruit citizens of Berlin as participants in our research. And by now we have a big pool of several thousands of people in our data bank who want to be contacted again for future experiments. So I think the general level of the general attitude is very positive.
Okay, that's really nice to hear. And so one thing I guess you were already touching on a bit is like how your research is being then I guess published, and also how it is in the public. So this is kind of a topic of open science as well. So what is your stance generally on open science?
There are many aspects about open science that I like a lot. If I had to choose one that I like the most, then it's everything that has to do with reproducibility. Replicability is a different issue, and there I have a more nuanced view, but something that I entirely am in favor of is reproducibility. And by that, I simply mean that in 20 years from now, I want to have some way of doing whatever I did with the data today that will get me exactly the same result. That is, I want a foolproof documentation of the procedures. And especially in a field where you do lots of pre-processing, as is the case, for instance, with brain data in my field, and where the fashions change, of course, people would always say, the techniques improve, but sometimes there's also some degree of arbitrariness to what we are doing with the data. In such instances, I consider it extremely important that we are just able to do whatever we did exactly in the same manner again, which of course also requires that the data need to be in a format that can be shared with others, that others can run other analyses, et cetera, et cetera. So everything that has to do with making data available, of course, respecting privacy rights and being able to reproduce the analyses, I consider extremely important. When it comes to pre-registration, I think it's good as long as people feel free to exploit the data in ways they have not thought before. That is, I think there is a place for hypothesis testing, and it's good to pre-register in order not to engage in cherry picking, etc., and not to inflate alpha errors. So it has its place. It is a contribution to scientific honesty. But just looking at the data and finding something that you haven't thought of before is also great and is not like inferior to hypothesis testing. Of course, then whenever you have found something, you need to replicate it, you need to understand it, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm all for being cautious about discoveries, but we should have both a hypothesis testing mind and a playful mind.
Mm-hmm. So perhaps as a last question, so nowadays we see in the digital era where information is spreading so fast, and so, you know, it's all about the quick, you know, reception of information. And that's where we have platforms like Twitter and something come into the picture, right? So where, you know, we see that, like, you know, there's a lot of scientific exchange on Twitter happening across different disciplines. there, like, you know, some publications being shared constantly, even job offers. Like, for example, I work with Zebrafish, and there's this page called Zebrafish Rock where they publish job offers in the field of zebrafish research. And also, like, a lot of these can be found on Twitter and sometimes even ahead of other sources of information. So what is your take on quick exchange of information like Twitter?
This question would almost require a podcast in itself to be answered, because I have a very differentiated and highly ambivalent view of the matter. First of all, I personally don't use Twitter simply because I'm fine with the communication channels that I have. And there is this beautiful word by Spinoza, omnes determinatio est negatio. And if I apply this to time management, it means that everything that you do implies another thing that you cannot do, because the time has 24 hours. And I just know that my communication budget is full, and I don't want to spend any additional time on communication, that because not because I don't like communication, because it would mean that there are other things that I would have less time for. So I personally do not use Twitter. Now, at the same time, I have a network of younger people, and this is also, of course, we are always talking also about a cohort question. So a cohort question that is confounded with an age question. So it's a highly complicated thing. I may not be using Twitter because I'm older, but I may not be using Twitter because I'm grew up in a different cohort. Just an aside. However, I do know that I heavily profit from these younger people who are using Twitter, because I use them as a resource myself, because if they find some cool article, they will use my old-fashioned email account and send me the article. So it's very cheap for me not to be using Twitter, because then it doesn't count on my time budget. And at the same time, I know I'm profiting from these people who are using Twitter. That's the first answer. The second answer is I do see some real dangers with Twitter. One danger that I see is the mix between private life and science. So I have seen some cases where I think the mix of private disclosures and confessions with informing about a conference or sharing a new set of data has not been beneficial for the people involved. And I'm sometimes a little bit concerned when I see like self-disclosures, confessions, political statements, et cetera, mixed with this information function that I mentioned before. I don't know whether people are always aware that these things can be read years after, and that you may found about the details of a divorce together with the report from a conference. And I honestly don't think that this mix is useful. So that's the first critique. The second critique is that I think there is a case to be made for slow science. And by that I mean some things are complex and don't profit from being expressed in one sentence. And of course, you don't. There is this person who currently is the head of the United States who may serve as a good example for what you can, in this case, do purposefully wrong by. Expressing complex things in a simplistic form. So, when, for instance, Herr Drosten started his Corona podcast, he made it very clear that he thinks that he needs at least 10 minutes to explain things that are complicated and that he won't do it below 10 minutes. And so I do see a tendency with some of the fast, fancy formats where you kind of also the science slams and so on. I don't want to condemn them. They might have their place, but we as scientists are responsible not only for getting a message across, but for getting a message across at the level of complexity that this topic deserves. And we should not be lured into making things too flashy and too simple when in reality they are difficult. So these are the mixture of the private and the science first thing, and the tendency to oversimplify second thing. These are the two reservations I have against Twitter, but I know many reasonable young people who are using Twitter, and I profit from their use of Twitter.
Okay. So I feel like a very comprehensive answer that you gave to us. But that does lead me to actually a short follow-up. So because we do live in a digital era where everything is online and the speed of exchange of information is so fast, how do you think scientific exchange can take place in such a sphere?
That's a very difficult question. I do think we need some filter function. And of course, the peer-reviewed journals are supposed to serve this filter function. Now, there are so many journals around that in the meantime, everyone can publish everything everywhere. Of course, then in outlets that might not be the ones where you want to get in. I agree with that. But all I want to say is that the question is, to what extent can the journals still fulfill the filter function? To some extent they can, but to some extent this has become difficult. So then the question is, how do you find out about what's solid work and what's not? Who are the gatekeepers? Who does the filtering? How much should we rely on citing things that is on preprint servers that have not yet, and have not yet been peer reviewed? And I really have to say, I don't have a good answer to this question right now. I think that things are changing, the best answer to give is read carefully whatever you read, but how do you know what to read and not to read and what not to read? I must say that I found answers to this question I would have found it easier to answer this question perhaps 20 years ago than I find it now. There are still a few journals that are kind of that come with a high likelihood of high quality work. I would say those that have the lowest margin of error are the best specialty journals. In the even more prestigious general purpose journals, such as Science and Nature, you may find the very best work, but sometimes you may also find work that was extremely flashy and later turns out not to be so sound. So I would say currently the best quality marker are those journals in your field that are high up and that you know for quite some time, and then you develop some, say, trust in whatever is in this journal. But to just make it short, I don't have a good answer to this question.
Okay. So I think with that we've come to the end of our discussion, which was, I think, very interesting. We really enjoyed talking to you, and we really hope that perhaps a year down in the future, with more experience as VP, like you mentioned before, we can come back and talk back to you to see how your opinions and things have developed.
count the gray hair and encounter a disillusioned. Let's see.
Thanks a lot for joining us.
Yes, really it was really great to have you on.
Well, that was a very interesting discussion with Professor Lindenberg, wasn't it? What are your thoughts, Nico?
Yeah, it was nice, especially that he recognized that the contracts for the PhD students in the humanities section should be increased, which I think is overdue already.
Yeah, definitely. And another thing that I keep, you know, coming back to is the outreach aspect of the things and the concept of citizen science, on which he had a rather unique take on. And of course, he sent us the link, which we will put in the show notes below, of the thing on citizen science for the video.
Yeah, I mean, it's great that he has a closer contact to the public, right? With having to ask people and doing these interviews, he'll get to know them better. And then also the people will realize what actually their contribution will bring to science. So just giving the people some, telling them what it's like to do science, it's nice, I think.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. Anyway, so I think with that, we've really come to the end of this season of episodes for Offspring Podcast. And this is like our 20th episode, and we've been doing this for 20 weeks running, or more even. Like, we started recording a bit before we started releasing episodes, right? So this has been an excellent journey for us, and we want to thank all the listeners for being such an active part and listening to this podcast, because we know there are a million podcasts out there and you might as well listen to any one of them, but you did choose to listen to the Offspring Podcast, and we're so happy that you did that.
Yes, it was really nice to know that people appreciate what we are doing, and also from the emails we got, it was nice to hear that people liked it as well. Thanks a lot for that.
And definitely, if you want us to cover any topics of your interest, which we have, I mean, there are so many topics of interest that we've missed out on, and we had to isolate ourselves to a specific few this year, but of course we're going to be covering more next year, and we have a huge time to brainstorm now and discuss different areas. So if you have any feedback or any ideas for us to cover next year, please feel free to write to us at offspring.podcasts@phdnet.mpg.de. We welcome your suggestion wholeheartedly. And so the thing is, we really need to take a break, and it's time for everyone to take a break. In fact, it's been a very stressful year indeed, and perhaps we should mention that we plan to start the next season of episodes sometime around end of January, early February next year. So you have to stay tuned for that. And Nico, you want to add anything to this?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're excited that we can keep doing this, and with also getting more people and so on, I hope that we can stay on a release schedule that is nice, where we can have like more content more often, instead of having to stop releasing at some point.
Yeah, definitely. And also, one thing which we need to emphasize is that our team is expanding. So you won't be bored with just listening to the two of our voices. You're going to have a few more interesting voices in the podcast to voice their opinions and be new hosts for the upcoming season. And a bonus episode for this season is coming up next week or the week after. I don't know. You'll see when we release it. Anyway, there's going to be a bonus episode where we introduce all the new members of the Offspring Podcast team. So stay tuned for that. And that's going to be probably where we end off this season. Anyway, with that, I really like to thank all of you for listening. And thank you all for being such an active part. And hope to see you all very soon. Until then, it's a bye-bye from me.
Bye.
Offspring Magazine, the podcast, is brought to you by the Max Planck PhDnet and the Science Communication Working Group known as the Offspring Magazine. The intro-outro jingle is composed by Srinath Ramkumar, and the pre-intro jingle is composed by Gustavo Carrizo. The podcast series is hosted by Srinath Ramkumar, Nicola Herman, Alison Lewis, Adrian LaHoya, and Sandra Fendel. If you'd like to give us any feedback, comments, or suggestions, please feel free to write to us at offspring.podcasts@phdnet.mpg.de. And with that, I will see you next week. Stay safe, stay healthy, and bye!